want to get started with a few introductory remarks, but not too many. Thank you for coming to the first session of the year, the first session of the semester. I want to say that tonight is special for us. Most of you know that we do these open forums all the time, but our national security open forums have been funded for the next year by the Polsky Foundation, who is a friend of the center and has been for a long time. So this is the first in the series, and so that makes us very happy. I want to tell you a little bit about what's happening to the center going forward. The good news is we don't have to do torture in Guantanamo anymore. The even better news is that some of the things we've wanted to pay attention to for a long time, we will now have the time and the energy and the resources to put into them. And so I thought I would mention some of these things. There'll be many more, and I don't want to go into detail on them. For one thing, we're going to continue the terrorist trial report card, which has become the mainstay of the media. And you know, we've done it with the Department of Justice, the old one, and so I assume we'll also be able to do it in collaboration with the new Department of Justice. And every day, I would say, it gets more and more interesting, because the more you work at it, the more you find. So we're looking forward to taking that forward. We're continuing our documentation process. This time, we're indexing the congressional hearings for matters of accountability, some of them related to torture, others to detention, others to the war in Iraq, others to surveillance and wiretapping. So stay tuned. But we have a number of new projects. And I know this is going to sound a little ridiculous, but this has been our best fundraising season ever. And I think the reason is that we do our best to try to put the money to good use. And so what we have coming forward, in addition to the things I've mentioned, is we are finishing up a project addressing the reorganization of the national security apparatus, which both Mike and Fran have helped on, that is making, well, ultimately make the recommendation that we don't need a radical reform in the national security structure, but in the culture, and we'll bring you more of that. We're launching a new program. It's our fourth program area in civilian-military relations, looking at everything from the draft and national service to, for lack of a better term, and Mike, I apologize, the use of the military for soft power. Until another one comes up, that's what I have to use. And we're expanding our foreign policy programming to include a very analytical project on diplomacy, what it is and what it should be going forward. And as part of that, we've started a study looking at what happened to the Department of State vis-a-vis the Department of Defense over the last 10 to 15 years. So, and our events will reflect all of these things. So we're going to have a lot of interesting, and we'll still try to keep them somewhat entertaining and digestible events for you. Tonight's event is one of those things that we would have loved to bring you earlier, but there's only so many nights in a semester. It's amazing that we've gotten this far, 6 years, without looking at WMDs. In particular, we're going to look at the WMD Commission report and talk somewhat analytically about what it means, how it came about, why we have it, and what it's going to mean for the future. Our moderator tonight is Dafna Linzer. I think you know her from some of our earlier events, but let me tell you a few things about her. She looks quiet and unassuming, but be very careful what you tell her, because she is an ace journalist whose specialties are the intelligence community and nonproliferation. She's worked in at least a dozen, if not more, countries on issues of nonproliferation. She's been received tremendous accolades and awards for her work on Iran and nonproliferation, and I'm sure you know her work on Baghdad and Iraq. So without any further ado, I turn over the night to Dafna, and I think you will have a great time.
Thank you. Thanks, Karen. So I'm going to start off by acknowledging that we are missing somebody, and it's Senator Graham, who could not get out of the airport at National in Washington, although he spent hours and hours and hours waiting for his flight today and tried very hard to get here. So we're going to have to move on without him. And Robin Cleveland, who is here with us, who is also a commissioner on the WMD Commission, is going to play both her role and Bob's role as commissioners who created this report, looking at basically issues of WMD and WMD terrorism as sort of a place for the Obama administration to start and go over its recommendations for us. Robin was a counselor to the president at the World Bank. I'm sure many of you know that. She was a senior staff member on a number of important Senate committees, including Senate Intelligence, Senate Foreign Relations, Senate Appropriations, and was a very senior person in the Office of Management and Budget. So she comes at this from several areas, including budgetary and development overseas and intelligence. And also with us is Mike Sheehan, also everyone knows from the center and his work here. Mike was the State Department's ambassador at large on counterterrorism, dealing with counterterrorism issues with foreign governments and foreign intelligence chiefs, and then became the deputy commissioner in New York City for counterterrorism after 9/11, and was incredibly important in sort of establishing the counterterrorism center here and very much changing the way NYPD and the city was focused on counterterrorism after September 11th. And nice homecoming for Fran Townsend, who started out in the Southern District here as a prosecutor in Brooklyn and spent many years rising in the Justice Department and became President Bush's advisor on Homeland Security. So, well, welcome to everyone, and I think we're going to start off. I think Robin is going to take us through some of the commission's findings and their recommendations. Mike and Fran will help us discuss them and go over how they think the recommendations can and could work and where they'll be helpful for the Obama administration, and then we'll open the forum up for questions and answers, obviously. So I turn it to Robin.
Thank you. I will not do Bob Graham justice. He is a.
Can you boost the sound, please, or closer?
My. Okay.
Thank you.
Does that work? Can you hear?
I don't know. I mean, that's
you can hear? All right. While I will try to play Bob Graham's role, I will not do him justice because he is a wonderful, wonderful storyteller. On September 20th this year, we had a very clear and sobering reminder that we still live in a very perilous world. The commission was en route to Pakistan and learned as we landed in Kuwait that the hotel we were going to stay in had been devastated by a bomb blast where more than 50 people died. And I think we found our field work for this report served as a reminder of the urgency of the mission and the issue. We were an outgrowth of the 911 commission that was set up to look at what had caused or what events had precipitated the attack on the United States. We were charged by Congress to look at the link between terrorism and weapons of mass destruction, how to keep the worst possible weapons out of the worst possible hands. While other commissions that preceded us looked at what went wrong, we were asked to have a forward-looking assessment of the threats posed to the United States by weapons of mass destruction and proliferation and terrorism. And our report, I think, provides a fairly good roadmap for how we think the threats that we face should be addressed. In brief, what we found was that the risks are evolving faster than our multi-layered defenses are prepared to defend us. The margin of safety is shrinking, not growing. The Commission believes that on the current trajectory, it is more likely than not that a weapon of mass destruction will be used somewhere in the world before the end of 2013. I think that's an assessment that was subsequently, once we reported, I think the DNI came out with a similar kind of assessment. We also determined, and I think it surprised all of us, that it's most likely that a biological attack will occur rather than nuclear. I think we've been focused on the nuclear issue for many years, but the Commission concluded unanimously that a bio attack was much more likely, and largely based on the fact that knowledge and material are much more available. We also were very much mindful of the fact that that terrorists are determined to attack us again. Osama bin Laden has said that it's a religious duty to perpetrate another Hiroshima, and the commission believes that it takes that threat seriously. The world is at risk in part because of a proliferation of new kinds of weapons. In the biotechnology field, proliferation of nuclear material with a coming age of renaissance of nuclear power, there are risks associated with that. And there is a nascent nuclear arms race in Southwest Asia, which the commission became very concerned with. We opted to center the Commission's findings on several areas. While we were given a broad landscape of chem, bio, radiological, and nuclear, we focused we narrowed the review to biological and nuclear terrorism because we think that's where the risk is the most serious. And we also focused on Pakistan, and we focused on the protocols and treaties related to nuclear security. In terms of risk, we think that, as I said, the bio threat is the most likely for two reasons. They're attractive to terrorists because of the potential to reload and inflict mass casualties, but also because of the potential for psychological fear. We learned in the 2001 anthrax attack that even a small-scale attack with limited lethality, as tragic as it was, can elicit a disproportionate amount of terror, social disruption, and economic consequences. I'm reluctant to talk extensively about this because I think we have one of the experts on this issue that actually appeared before the commission here in Len Cole, but I think your estimate came out that it was about $6 billion in economic damage. So it's an attractive weapon, it's readily available, it's relatively inexpensive, and it can inflict enormous physical as well as psychological damage. On the nuclear front, I think what we were most concerned about was that as power demands increase and the likelihood that more countries will seek nuclear power, so too does the risk increase of diversion and potential theft. There is already a surfeit of nuclear material in the world with more than 40 countries currently having nuclear material available. Fortunately, 95% of that is in Russia and the United States. I think we felt that the report didn't sugarcoat the threat, but we also felt very strongly that we are not helpless, that when America acts, we make progress. And so we came out with several very clear recommendations. I think first and foremost, we recommend that President Obama and the new Congress initiate a strengthening of our policy when it comes to Pakistan. We think that Pakistan represents probably the most serious challenges both to America's short and medium-term interest. It has nuclear weapons. It has a history of periods of instability. We've had experiences with proliferation with their senior nuclear scientists, and parts of the country are virtually ungovernable. I think virtually all experts we talk to, and I think probably Fran and most of the panelists would agree, that the most likely terrorist attack, if it occurs against the United States, is likely to originate in the federally administered tribal areas in Pakistan. I think we feel strongly that we act decisively to remove terrorist safe havens, secure nuclear and biological material in Pakistan, counter and defeat extremist ideology, and constrain the budding nuclear arms race in Southwest Asia. I think that while the commission hasn't met to discuss it, we would all welcome the fact that President Obama has taken an aggressive posture when it comes to pursuing al-Qaeda and has initiated or built on the Bush administration's record of strikes. Speaking personally and not for the commission, I would say that the envoy that was selected got it about two-thirds right. I think the one thing that we realized in the review is that Pakistan is seized with India as a threat. And as long as we are addressing Afghanistan and Pakistan and not focusing on the simmering dynamic between India and Pakistan, I'm not sure that we're going to fully affect or bring about stability or resolution of tensions. Pakistan was first. The second issue we have to focus on is bioterrorism. As I said, there's very easy access to material. You can grow it in your backyard. And as one person who testified before the commission said, if you wanted to work on SARS in the bathtub in your basement, you can, because there's no reporting requirements, there's no federal supervision, and there's no single, I think the thing that concerned us the most was there's no single agency with responsibility for the entire sort of range range of issues. I think we were all sort of surprised by the fact that this is a largely unregulated area, but I think it has come about, and my colleagues who are journalists can probably speak to this better, that there's a balance between protecting the country and protecting freedom of research. And the academic science community feels very strongly that they should be able to pursue vigorously their research. I think the commission was very mindful of trying to strike the right balance, but felt that there were four things that we needed to move quickly to do. We needed to improve oversight of high containment labs and security procedures at those labs. As I said, there's no single set of operating procedures. There's no one place you can go and find clear guidelines in terms of enforcement of security at these labs. Second, we need to improve microbial forensics that are administered by the government. The fact that it took 7 years to identify who may have been responsible for the anthrax attack did not surprise the commission members. The quality and state of microbial forensics is not what it should be. We also need to mobilize the life sciences community, because without their engagement and willingness to develop protocols for supervision of research, the threat will continue. And then finally, the commission recommended that the Obama administration, and this is one of those great sort of open-ended and vague recommendations, that the Obama administration make every effort to secure universal adherence to the Biological Weapons Convention that was signed 36 years ago. However, we did not recommend that we renew negotiations over a verification protocol. On North Korea, well, North Korea and Iran have obviously been developing capabilities rapidly over the last several years. I think the commission was, to be frank, divided on how to proceed. We did not want to get into line item detail as to whether or not what kind of negotiating strategy should be pursued. I think we were fairly split in terms of what the best next steps would be, both on Iran and North Korea. So we recommended that they be put at the top of the priority list, but did not get into much more in terms of detail on that. We did think that initiatives like the Global Initiative to Combat Nuclear Terrorism that the United States launched with Russia and the Proliferation Security Initiative were efforts that should be expanded and improved on. Both were, I guess, started during the Bush administration. Another key recommendation was we felt the burden of proof should shift from when it came to countries that chose to withdraw from the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, and that there should be a consensus and effort at the United Nations to ensure if you withdraw from that treaty that intrusive oversight would kick in fairly quickly. That right now the burden of proof is on countries that are concerned about noncompliance, but it's very difficult to gain access to determine whether there are concerns for proliferation. So I think we recommend that there should be a new policy to focus on shifting that burden. My notes say we should get our own government house in order. I think there's been a lot of discussion, and I'd be interested to hear what Fran has to say. The commission focused on the establishment of the Homeland Security Committee and council, and whether or not we should merge the two so there is clear reporting to the president. I think, again, there were different points of view, but I think that it may make some sense to revisit that issue. We felt very strongly that there ought to be a senior person in the White House who's focused on this issue on a day-by-day basis, because far too often proliferation concerns have come in second to economic and other geopolitical issues. The other key recommendation, and I'm not confident that any of us, or I don't think any of us were confident there would be aggressive action on this, but we really think the Congress needs to reform itself in terms of how it conducts oversight and of the Homeland Security and national security missions. There are 84 different committees that Homeland Security now has to report to. I think they that Nancy Pelosi told us with some pride that that had been reduced to 82, but it's still, I think it's, and it was Governor Napolitano's first question to the commission members, which is, what's your recommendation on how I deal with this? Because it really will consume an enormous amount of her time that should be better invested on her primary mission. And then the other thing that I think that we felt strongly about was the American citizen has to be engaged. My good friend James Harmon kicked us the first day out of the box saying that we were fear-mongering. And I don't think that any of us felt that this was an effort to elevate fear or anxiety. I think we felt it was an effort to educate the public. We came away from Scotland Yard very impressed with the fact that the UK has a very active community-based terrorism approach and takes the view that communities defeat terrorism. It's not the single policy of a single entity. So I think our hope is to continue to engage the public on this issue and educate a broader public as to what can be done to defeat the risk. I think I'll leave it at that.
Great, thank you. I think, you know, looking at the recommendations, two things really stood out when the report first came out, which was in December, and the recommendations were issued. One was, as Robin said, this idea that the possibility of a terrorist attack within the next 5 years, and the commission's view that this would be the chances were greater that this would be a biological threat. And I'm going to jump right off the fear-mongering idea. This seems very frightening until you remember that 7.5 years ago we had a bioterror attack here in New York City with the anthrax investigation. So I think I'm going to actually just throw it first to Mike to just talk a little bit about that, about the idea of another bioterror attack and what the possibilities are and how things have changed since the first one. And also maybe address the idea of a terrorism or a terror WMD czar in the White House, or the idea of another envoy. And then maybe afterwards, Fran, too, if you would address that as somebody who is inside and seeing sort of firsthand how many advisors the president has and the way they juggle the different issues and where there is room or not room to carve out for another high-level czar in that area.
Thank you. First, I'd like to say it's a very good report. I know how difficult it is to gain consensus on a report with that, which has a tendency to diffuse some of the recommendations, and that's some of the unfortunate things about a committee report like that, is I think it accurately describes the problem. But on the report, I think there's a bit of a disconnect between how the seriousness of the problem and then a little bit of the fuzziness in the recommendations, and that comes from gaining consensus. And I'll come back to that, and I'm sure there are members on the commission that wanted to be more hard hitting certain areas, but you have to find consensus, and I'm aware of that. But it would be nice to be able to, you know, take the gloves off on recommendations as that would be commensurate with the level of the threat that's described in the report. But you wanted me to talk about the inevitability of another attack in 5 years. I don't like to get into those. I don't like those projections, because it was, when you say it's not when, but not if, but when. Most of those predictions, by the way, have gone wrong. You know, they're about nuclear war between the U.S. and the Soviet Union didn't happen. The loose nukes of the 90s didn't happen. Y2K was a bust. And the Al-Qaeda re-attack, it's bad for my business, hasn't happened either in the northern Western Hemisphere, at least, except for in North America, at least. So will there be another bio or WMD attack in the next 5 years? Not necessarily, in my view. There may be little fizzly ones. And I'll say this, that most of the time, terrorism, by the way, is an instrument of the weak. And they really strike at your psyche as much as your physical being or your infrastructure. And most of the time, the actual physical attack, whatever they conduct, whether it be an improvised explosive, or if they were able to do an improvised chemical, biological, or radiological attack, the actual attack will be much less than the hysteria surrounding it. So I'd just like to preface it by saying that we should be prepared for one of these attacks and recognize that it probably won't be 10% as bad as when the media starts going crazy when a biological pathogen or a chemical or radiological event happens. So it's very, very important to retain a relentless focus on stopping these organizations conducting attack, but not overreact when they have one, or else you play into the hands of the terrorists by amplifying the impact of the attack on people or infrastructure. So that's on that. And the other one you wanted to ask me about, the bureaucracy?
Well, the idea of the terrorism czar.
Yeah, I think there's a value of having a centralized person like Fran was at the White House, and that can, you know, whip the agencies into shape and has the mandate of the president behind that person. There's value in that. I would also say, though, that I think it's equally important to pin the tail on the agency that's responsible. And there's where you guys didn't get that quite right, in my view, in the report. I think that, by the way, the regulatory agencies on materials in the United States, it should not be Health and Human Services for bio. It should not be the nuclear commissions for radiological or nuclear or chemical industry for the chemicals. I think it should be in DHS, which is a troubled organization because they have no mandate. But if the president turned to the secretary of the DHS and said, you're in charge of this, you're responsible for setting the standards for biolabs, for setting the standard for safeguarding of radiologic materials in construction or in hospitals, you're responsible for the chemical plants around. And you got to get it right, and if you don't get it right, you're fired. And I'm going to come back to you in 2 years, and I want to see those standards established, and I want to find out a way that you're going to force people to do it. And by the way, I believe you don't need reorganization to do that. You don't even need any new money to do that. You just need political courage and leadership and pinning responsibility and say, do it, and come back to me in 18 months, and let me know who's in your way. We'll steamroll over them. And those are the things, if you're really serious about this, that's the type of action that's required. Otherwise, you're just talking about a threat and it's business as usual in Washington, which means nobody's really accountable for anything. Everyone's pointing a finger at everybody else, and things never really progress. We have made progress in biolab security, definitely better, the level 3 and level 4, but a long way to go, 7 years after the anthrax attack here in the U.S. And who's in charge? Nobody.
Well, you have USDA involved as well. I mean, I think that's part of the challenge.
There's always a lot of agencies involved, but I would put one in charge and say, if I were the president and sitting around my cabinet, I'd put my finger in the chest of one person and say, you are responsible for that, and all the other agencies, you work with them. And fight it out, and if you can't resolve it, come back to someone like Fran who can referee it. If she can't, goes to the president and they make a decision, and you steamroll people. Otherwise, it'll be another 7 years, and we'll still be here saying level 3 labs and 4 labs are grossly inadequately protected. Sorry, I went a little long.
No, it's good. Fran, you talk a little bit about, can you add a WMD counterterrorism advisor to the president? And if you did, would that be the person who was going to start redoing policy on Pakistan? And as the commission says, Pakistan is the center of terrorism and WMD threats that the United States is facing. I mean, is that the right way to go?
Let me break this down, because I want to make sure people aren't, the bureaucratic boxes are not interesting, but it's important that we at least talk about them right. There's been discussion about a WMD czar in the White House. There's been talk about the merger between the Homeland Security Council and the National Security Council. These are separate issues, related but separate issues. Let me just mention, as a preface to this, there's a current sort of infatuation with this notion of czars. Bureaucratically, that may have sounded pejorative. Let me just describe to you kind of practically what the issue is. You have cabinet members who are selected by the president, Senate confirmed, and operationally accountable to the president, to Congress, and to the American people for how their departments run. Which means, if they're going to be held accountable, you've got to give them the authority and the ability then, and the room to actually execute against their mission. The problem, it went with, and it's funny to hear me say this, having served in the White House, if you listen to cabinet members who have served, they feel absolutely oppressed by czars and White House staff. Why? because they're getting direction on the execution of how they do their mission. And so if you've got White House staff and czars, the only thing worse for a cabinet secretary of one or the other is to have both. And so as you look at how we are organized, because it diffuses, and it's bad for the American people, and I will tell you why that's my view, is because it diffuses accountability. When the mission doesn't go well, when the thing, the important thing doesn't get done, name your policy issue, who gets fired, to Mike's point? It's important that you can answer that, by the way, because accountability in government, the transparency and accountability, is what forces action inside the bureaucracy. And so, as you see this, when there are important issues and you have multiple very senior positions around the president, inevitably, those people, if, assume you have a three, a cabinet secretary, a czar, and somebody on the president's staff, inevitably, those three people are not going to see the issue the same. Inevitably, those three senior people are going to give him different advice. And by the way, every time they disagree, if they went to the president, he could do nothing, nothing. He could get nothing done. So they don't all get to him. To Mike's point, they don't all go up. Some of them get resolved, some of them don't get resolved. It's a potential vulnerability to the country in terms of making progress, and a vulnerability to the success of the president if he's not very careful to watch and manage it. I can tell you this from experience. In the prior administration, there were such disagreements. Some got served up, some didn't. A lot of it's got to do with who's most empowered by the president. In my own experience, depending on the cabinet secretary, it was different. There was no question that my proximity to the president and my relationship with him allowed me to do more of what Mike describes as steamrolling, what I suspect the cabinet secretaries involved would have described as steamrolling. But you didn't get to do it every time because you couldn't serve them all up. And so that's a long way of saying to you, beware of this whole czar concept. Watch how the president manages and who he's empowering, because it's critically important. Just a little bit of reading current tea leaves. The fact that the president and the vice president went to the State Department in the first 48 hours tells you something about the president's empowerment of the Secretary of State. Okay, if that's the message, then who bureaucratically, power-wise, is the loser or diminished? Well, the National Security Advisor. Now, this is an educated crowd, so I'm not going to do my usual raise your hand if you think you know the name of the National Security Advisor. I'm sure you all do. But you can see pretty clearly right now that the president has put his weight in the foreign policy community behind the Secretary of State. Watch this space. Okay, let me just mention now the merger of Homeland Security and National Security Councils. I had responsibility over a piece of the National Security Council. It was not a neat arrangement. Twice during the course of the Bush administration, I advocated, actually, for the merger of the two. I was persuaded I was wrong by two different National Security Advisors because, their argument, when you're a country at war in two theaters, Afghanistan and Iraq, the National Security Advisors got a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week job without the ability to really spend the necessary time on hurricanes, wildfires, earthquakes, grant process, preparedness, all the things that I was doing. And they needed somebody at that rank to be able to pull cabinet members together to spend time on that. I don't think it really matters. The bottom line to my view on HSC, NSA, I don't much care about the org boxes. I care about the function. As long as the person who does my job, which is now John Brennan in the new administration, has direct access to the president, doesn't have to go through anybody, has to be immediate direct access to the president, and has the necessary staff to do the job, I don't much care. I don't think it matters, and I don't much care how you put the boxes on the chart.
So, Frank, go ahead and talk a little bit about some of the foreign policy issues that would come up now on WMD and counterterrorism. For example, the thing that interested me, you know, one of the recommendations again on Pakistan was moving forward with Pakistan to secure nuclear materials in Pakistan, except they won't tell us where they are. The president of Pakistan wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post today describing all the issues that face the United States and Pakistan and their relationship, and the word nuclear is not in the article. So talk a little bit about that. That's not an easy thing to do. It sounds like a great idea. Well, in practice, how does it work?
this is hard. This is sort of like the NSC-HSC problem. I mean, there's multiple ways you can do it. I think it is the right recommendation in this regard. There was legislation that was passed by Congress suggesting this. It was opposed by the prior administration. I do think that there is a gap between the counterproliferation community and the counterterrorism community. While during my time at the White House, they were two separate things. They were very difficult because they were organized separately to bring them together. Only by bringing them together can you actually see where the gaps in the policy and the operations are. And so I am a believer that you need someone that looks across both from the counterproliferation perspective through the counterterrorism perspective. We have, under the Director of National Intelligence, a National Counterproliferation Center and a National Counterterrorism Center, and I spent way too much time trying to make sure they were talking to each other. So somebody needs to wake up and worry about this every single day. It's got to be somebody that looks across the spectrum. That doesn't solve, having now just said I think the recommendation is right, that does not solve the attendant foreign policy problems. It is important that whoever that is is a direct report into the National Security Advisor and sits as part of the National Security Council, because that's where your agenda gets set with Pakistan and India and Iran and other nuclear powers. I think the Commission's observations on North Korea, Iran, and Pakistan are good, but I would defy folks to say how they were different from the prior administration's policy. It basically, the Commission, the good news is this is a bipartisan report. The bad news is it needed to go further. And I think, as Mike acknowledged, you have a bipartisan commission. The fact that they think it's sort of the foundation was right and it ought to be more, better, is right. But the new administration isn't going to get much in terms of how to do that. What are the next tactics? And I suspect that's because there's disagreement on the commission.
Yes. Yes, there was. And on your point, I think it is extraordinarily important on the Counterproliferation Center and the Counterterrorism Center. I'm not quite sure what the numbers are, but the Counterterrorism Center, which has operational responsibility, is several hundred people, as opposed to, I think there are 10 in the, I mean, that's an understatement, but the Counterproliferation Center is very, very small and has less access, less interaction with the White House, and is sort of a poor orphan, I think. And our recommendation on that was that within 180 days, the DNI recommend whether or not the two centers should be merged, and how to address the issue.
Okay, well, Mike, I'll ask you, the bottom line for the commission, you know, coming out of 8 years of the Bush administration, of a policy, as Robin said, of how to prevent the worst weapons from getting into the hands of the worst people, and the axis of evil, Iran, North Korea, and Iraq. Iraq, a country not mentioned in the WMD commission report for obvious reasons. What do you do now going forward with Iran and North Korea especially, and then of course Pakistan?
I'm actually more concerned about the non-state actors. I think you have to focus on those three states, but I actually believe that they're all rational, and they can be pressured. And that includes Ahmadinejad and Kim Jong-il. I had the fortune of actually meeting, and he's pretty wacky. But he's a bizarre human being. But I think he also is rational in when it comes to retaining power, which is what those guys are mostly about, and these weapons they dangle out there to do that, and with some degree of success. So I think those issues are of reining those folks in are issues for the Secretary of State, and they're done best when they can do it multilaterally by bringing heat onto them. And we talked about this last night, Fran. Fran and I were at an event on the same subject last night. The issue of China and Russia. If you don't get China and Russia on board, you're not going to do anything about North Korea or Iran. You're really going against some strong headwinds. So I think the challenge for Secretary Clinton and for the foreign policy team is how high on the agenda are you going to push this issue for Russia and China? And when you got other issues on the agenda for them, China, particularly economic issue, how high are you going to push it up on there? Because you're just not going to be able to get at Pyongyang or Tehran without going through Moscow and Beijing, respectively. So I'll end there.
I think you've pointed something out that I overlooked in my remarks. The commission went to Russia right after the incursion into Georgia, and I think we were all expecting a fairly frosty reception and came away impressed by the desire of particularly the military to, even in times of extraordinarily difficult international tension, an eagerness to continue to work with us, and went so far as to suggest that there ought to be a whole new working relationship on Iran between Russia and the U.S. Whether some of us believed that was as credible as they were suggesting, I think we all came away with the sense that Russia was essential in the dynamic with Iran. We didn't visit China, but I would agree with you that's key to Pyongyang.
Fran, doesn't that sound familiar?
Yes.
Yeah. but I hope they're more successful than we've been. I mean, we've made some progress, but I mean, I don't think anybody is satisfied that we've made enough progress on either North Korea or Iran, and least of all, many of our allies. I mean, people are very frustrated. And so the question is going to become, can the new administration come up with a better menu of carrots and sticks? I will tell you, agree or disagree, it was not for a lack of effort at that, identifying the right carrots and sticks the last 8 years. This is a very difficult problem, but it belies what Mike just said. What we need is more than sort of the right words out of some of the people who've got the most influence. They cannot. We have to find a way to incentivize their real engagement on this. Because lip service is not enough, and actually it's detrimental because the people you're trying to influence understand lip service from the allies.
Mm-hmm. And do you think that having a new administration is going to make a difference with Russia and China? Do their interests change dramatically in ways that will make a difference on issues like Iran and North Korea?
I see no reason to think that our change in administrations will change. Look, our allies around the world act in their own national interest. Their own national interest doesn't change because we elect a different president or a different political party. And so we've got to be very pragmatic. We've got to take a very practical look at how we can influence them. But that's why I say to you, it's very difficult. And I don't think our election necessarily changes that.
Mm-hmm. And one more thing for Mike. You were saying that you're not that afraid of the states. You're much more afraid of the non-state actors. Do you not believe in the whole concept of the states giving WMD to terrorists, which was a big driving part of the Bush policies?
I think it's the biggest challenge, without a doubt. And I think both presidential candidates spoke about that, not only in this election, but in the last one, that it is the number one challenge, that the leak of a really weaponized from a state to a non-state actor is the biggest challenge. I just think the chances of that are much lower. The higher possibility is a improvised weapon of mass destruction by an organization that has no restraint, like Al-Qaeda and a few others. And so I think that's a more likely one and probably less devastating. You have to do both. As Fran said last night, I'll quote her, you have to walk and chew gum at the same time. We have to try to put pressure on those states that have these weapons to make sure they don't leak, but I also think that the primary focus has to be on some of these organizations. And in that regard, I just want to emphasize here, I believe it's an intelligence function, primarily. And that means overseas it's the CIA and domestically it's the FBI. And those two people should have fingers put in their chest and say, remember, above all things that you're doing out there every day, you have to make sure no organization is able to develop the capacity to put together one of these weapons, whether it be Aum Shinrikyo, which had a lot of scientists, a lot of money, and still kind of flubbed it in Tokyo, or whether it be Al-Qaeda, that surely has an intent, but has floundered in also in trying to put that together. Those two organizations can never lose their focus on looking at the organizations trying to put that and keep them under relentless pressure, because it's not easy to put this stuff together. And if you keep those organizations under great pressure, I think it minimizes their ability to do it. And by the way, that'll also help you with the leakage, because mm-hmm. if it doesn't leak from a state and there's an ability to leak, if you have the organizations wrapped up, it'll help that end of the policy as well.
I think that the that's true when it comes to nuclear and radiological, but less so with bio. I think the distinction I draw is that access to the basic materials, whether it's from the medical community or science, the life sciences community, I think it's a different dynamic in terms of a terrorist organization's potential. Sorry, terrorist organization's potential access to.
Play that out for me a little bit.
The challenge is with nuclear, whether it's civilian or a weapon, you have regulatory authorities that essentially govern the safety and security of that material. You have, whether for good, better, or otherwise, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. You have the Defense Department, which more recently has demonstrated it may not have quite the control that we thought. But you do have protocols and norms, procedures, and organizations that are responsible for the safe supervision of the material. In the bio world, that's not true.
I agree.
It is not difficult to either put together or imagine the use of a very, very small amount of very toxic material. And I'm not sure I agree with you that Amshin Rikyo flubbed it in Tokyo. I think there's a lot of thinking going on as to whether or not it was a potential testing of capability.
But they could have done more damage with a 9mm pistol.
They could have, but the question is sort of what were they really interested in accomplishing? Yeah. And it was a small amount, and in a subway system that the consequences could have been horrific. Yeah.
Well, and let me just add to Robin's point about the access and availability to biomaterials. I mean, I can remember, I won't say what the virus was, but material was, but it could be very toxic materials are capable of being ordered and purchased over the internet. Now, a doctor on my staff in the White House came to me and said, "Are you aware of?" You can well imagine my reaction. But this goes to the Commission's recommendations about supervision of life sciences research and the life sciences community. It is a very difficult issue, and I actually think this is one of those things that, as opposed to the government saying, we need to do this, we need to conduct this supervision, that we should first encourage the life sciences community and the scientific community to try and undertake some structure in which they look at these sorts of issues and see if that, how good can they do it on their own without the government being directly involved as a first step, frankly, in, you know, you can always get to the government doing it or getting more involved
and
in it.
When it comes to synthetic biomaterials, in fact, there has been sort of a voluntary effort by some of the members of the medical community. There is some inclination to try to come up with a voluntary code of conduct and procedures for managing research so that the government doesn't jump in. I have a feeling, however, based on the hearing we had with the House, with the Senate Government Affairs and Homeland Security Committee, that they are moving out aggressively to establish procedures mm-hmm. for supervision of the private sector and right. life sciences. It may generate a voluntary kind of code to avoid legislation.
Okay. I think we're going to move to questions shortly. I think I might start with the first one, and maybe even the first two. But I wanted to ask you, in the report, this is an issue I think a little bit Iran-focused in the report, but I think it extends everywhere. When it talks about, as Fran said, kind of developing the right carrots and sticks and dealing with the Iranians and negotiating with the Iranians, then it says, and if that doesn't work, the Iranians need to know that we'll take direct action. It didn't say military action, it said direct action. And I wanted to know why the commission chose those words and what did they mean by them.
She read it carefully.
Yeah, I did read it.
The art of consensus. The art of consensus building. It was probably the most haggled over section of the report, as you can imagine. I think the position the commission wanted to be in and or not be in. We didn't want to want to be in a position where we tied the hands of the next president. And I think there was consensus that all options ought to be on the table. This isn't new. I mean, I don't think there's ever been a president in the history of the country that hasn't said, I'm not taking any options off the table. But I think there was a desire not to be antagonistic, not to to preempt or suggest that we were only interested in a military option, but it was the art of trying to find a consensus. And it was a long night when we wrote those that particular paragraph. So
is the threat of preemptive force gone, Fran or Mike, in any way?
I mean,
on dealing with these issues, especially WMD?
I don't think so. I mean, look, what your question suggests is, given the failure of the intelligence in Iraq, does that mean that the sort of whole doctrine of preemption, has it been undermined? Yes, it's been undermined. Do I think that means it's necessarily off the table? I mean, I wouldn't presume to speak for a new president. I don't think he's indicated. But I don't think you can presume it's off the table unless he says it. And to
but
Robin's
I don't think
point,
he's likely to.
I don't think he's likely to.
Why would
to.
He want to remove that option? I mean, right. I think you'll see chance. Subtle changes right. in the rhetoric so right. that it might not be a dead or alive mentality that we heard at one point. But I think you're
Well, I wondered if direct action was what was capturing that yes. that change.
I want to go back to it. It was the effort to achieve consensus. I mean, I think there were certainly members on the commission that felt very strongly that we ought to declare decisively that military action was an option. But there were other members of the commission that felt equally strongly that would only be perceived as bellicose and a continuation of rhetoric that the new administration wanted to get away from. So,
okay.
The solemn.
Just put the baby.
Yeah.
Should we open? People ready to ask? Well, there's mics, so just let me know. Why don't you? We'll start with you. Or just bring you a mic. Just let us know who you are and if the question is directed to anyone in particular.
I'm Luke Clarivas. I teach the counterterrorism and homeland security course here at NYU at the Center for Global Affairs. And I have a real simple question. Well, it's a quick question. I don't know if it's a simple answer, which is why 2013? Where did that number come from?
This is the 5 years from now for the for people who don't know that the possibility of a bioterror attack that the WMD Commission was identifying as a date.
And I want to be clear, the initial media accounts indicated that we thought it would happen in the United States. We didn't say that. We were very clear that this could happen anywhere in the world. And I think, in fact, I'm trying to think if there was any dissent from this. We thought it was less likely to be in the United States and more likely to be someplace like Southwest Asia. It came about after extensive discussions with primarily with the intelligence community, and I think it was a sense of a combination of will, access to material, and access to know-how. Senator Graham likes to say that it's not likely that terrorists will become biologists, but rather that biologists will become terrorists. And I think it was, to some extent speculation, but I think it was the judgment of when can you bring together capability, people, and the material. And the assessment was that it's a sooner rather than a later proposition.
I guess you never lose out from going with sooner rather than later. I would say something about predictions, just having written a lot about a lot of predictions that never really seemed to come true. I was going through some old notebooks about a year ago and came across a notebook from a briefing at the Israeli Defense Ministry in 1995 with one of their WMD experts who gathered a group of foreign reporters together in Tel Aviv and gave us a briefing about nuclear capabilities around the world. And looking over my notebooks, the Israelis said that they knew for certain and that their estimates were in line with the CIA's that Iran would have a plutonium-based nuclear weapon in 2003.
So, you know, that was a long time ago, and that was certainly based on all of the intelligence they had then, and they believed at the time that the Iranians were going the plutonium route with the Russians, and that all turned out to be wrong. And they knew nothing of AQ Khan, who was already very busy selling and distributing and running around. And, you know, I think it is a good reminder a lot of the times about sort of estimates and where the intelligence community is. And
you can speak better to that, but just how
fluid things are. Sure, you know that for your class.
Do either of you want to say
I think part of it, though, was a desire to in terms of, and we did debate whether it should say sooner rather than later, and that sounded very mushy. And I think that the commissioners felt strongly that we had allowed 7 years to lapse since the anthrax events, and we needed to push fairly hard to improve the quality of government effort and policy. And if we'd said sooner rather than later, we'd be listening to Mike say the art of consensus is alive and well. So,
I'd just like to say, if you really believe that it was going to be in 5 years, and the recommendations are not strong enough, there's just a breakdown there. And I would not advocate, if it's going to be within 5 years, that we allow the community to come up with voluntary standards. That's not going to get it, in my view. I don't think they'll ever get there.
Senator Lieberman and Senator Collins agreed with you on that.
Doesn't connect.
Sir.
Hello, my name's Harry. I just got interested in these issues because I see the war on terror is like affecting us everywhere, and like trying to learn more about how it evolves. And I just want to say, I didn't like that joke about the North Korean president. Everyone kind of laughed at that. And I find that kind of dehumanization is what leads to great violence, like we've been experiencing as of late. And I really found that odd in a university setting. But in any case, I find that no one mentioned US policy as having a role in fostering terrorism. I don't know if that was part of the study's overview or what, but to me, it's pretty glaring that's the case. Also, who are the terrorists? I keep hearing about terrorists. I even see on page 16 of the executive summary, you also call them activists. And with the sense of homegrown terrorism and FBI in America using the war on terror to take away more civil liberties, I wonder if you address who are the terrorists.
Okay,
and then two more things. Two more quick things. With everything being on the table, has it been considered that there be a nuclear-free Middle East so that Iran could come to, you know, to the table? And then finally, Ms. Cleveland, you said something about Obama continuing Bush's strikes on Pakistan. That's killing civilians, and you kind of said that like that was a good thing. So I wonder if you know that.
Killing civilians is not a good thing.
And Kim Jong-il is bizarre.
Well, I think what the commission would welcome, just on the Pakistan issue, is the Fatah is, as I said, largely ungoverned area, and I think that candidate Obama, President-elect Obama, and now President Obama has made clear that where U.S. security interests are at stake, he thinks it's important to take action on credible information and intelligence to remove that threat. And so I think we agreed prior to the elections that policy should be continued, and I think welcome the fact that the president is engaging in, and let me add to it, maybe to speak to your concern. I think it's important that he engage in the kind of action that he is in terms of taking no options off the table militarily, but I also think it's important that he spoke to Al Arabiya as his first interview, and I think my view is he has a unique opportunity, given his personal history, and to establish an open hand and reach out to a community and constituency that has largely felt misunderstood and disconnected from American political interests. I hope that he can sustain that. I hope that we will begin a new era of public diplomacy in the Muslim world in particular. But I fear that my experience with bureaucracies, you have 16 different agencies right now that are and offices that are engaged in forming the message of what the United States conveys overseas. Now, perhaps the president can step above all of that and carry forth a clear, coherent, single message. But I hope that we are on a new track. But I don't think you can pursue public diplomacy without the military option. I don't think you can pursue the military option without the public diplomacy. And I think it's the merging of the two that will secure success.
Go ahead. Tell us also just what is the sense of the nature of the threat and who are the terrorists today?
Let me, two direct things to what the question was. One, predator strikes have at times killed civilians. To Robin's point, that's a bad thing. They have also killed senior operational leaders of Al-Qaeda, and we have stopped attacks in the United States and around the world as a result of them. So, while killing civilians is a bad thing, you are constantly, when you pull the lever in a booth, you are giving responsibility to your government in an individual to protect you. And they make judgments, some of which you don't like, but most of the time help to keep you safe. I agree with what Robin said about public diplomacy. It is a necessary, one of the most effective and necessary tools. I think the not only was the first broadcast interview on Al Arabiya, the first phone call, foreign leader phone call, was to Mahmoud Abbas. Particularly when you join those two things together, it sends a very important message. I would say I think we've got to have realistic expectations. Even the most effective public diplomacy program, and I think the president is off to a good start. People will not, I come back to where I started in one of my earlier things, and that is nations act in their own self-interest. This is not about liking us. They act in their own self-interest. So even if they like us more, it doesn't necessarily mean that we're safer. I still think we need to do it, and I think we need to do a better job of it. I just don't think people should misunderstand what you're going to get from it. People are still going to target us to kill us. You know, you asked me a question, sorry.
Just, again, sort of at this stage, so many years after September 11th, sort of who are the terrorists?
Okay, I think people wish you could say it's Al-Qaeda.
I know.
Full stop, period, and move on. It's not. Terrorism is a tactic, and it's what groups can you identify that are willing to use the tactic, that is, kill innocent civilians, target and kill innocent civilians because of their beliefs or ideology. Al-Qaeda's among them, the Taliban's among them, Hamas, Hezbollah. Some of these also have political agendas. Some of them also have social welfare programs. I don't denigrate those, but if they're willing to use violence to achieve their ideology, then you got to put Hamas and Hezbollah in that group. There are domestic groups, environmental domestic groups that resort to violence to achieve their aims. And so there's not a single answer to the question of, is there one label I can put on them? This is who uses this tactic to achieve their objective.
I would divide terrorists into two different groups. What I call in my book restrained terrorists and unrestrained terrorists. Many of the terrorists, most of the terrorist organizations in the world are restrained. They use terrorism as a tactic for a political objective, and they live in the real world. Al-Qaeda and other associated groups affiliated with them really are unrestrained. If they could put their hands on a weapon of mass destruction tomorrow, they would execute it right away. Most other groups would not, because they have broader political agendas and regional agendas. I don't think Hamas or Hezbollah, for instance, would. So I would separate them a little bit from Al-Qaeda. They're terrorist organizations, they're dangerous organizations, they have potential, they have capacity, but they're probably more restrained than Al-Qaeda. That's why the government remains focused on Al-Qaeda. They have the intent, a clear intent, and want to pursue that weapon and use it if they got their hands on it. So they remain on the top of the list. There's lots of other ones below that as well.
Sir?
I have a two-part question about something much more specific. Oh, I'm Tony Barco. I run a center here at the law school on criminal law, and I was a terrorism prosecutor in the Southern District of New York before that. I have a specific question about two things much more narrow than some of the restructuring and the committees that these organizations have to report to, and they relate to PALs, which I think stands for Permissive Access mm-hmm. Links, and also funding for information sharing with Ron Noble was here the other day talking about Interpol and how he would like to get basically the budget for a rounding error in the defense budget to fund more information sharing between local and federal and world police authorities. So I wanted to know what is being done and what the likelihood of that happening, and then with respect to permissive access links, what the status is of congressional legislation on it and what the efficacy or inefficacy is of that as a method of controlling weapons of mass destruction and particularly nuclear materials.
I can't answer the PALS question. I don't know this. I don't know the status.
I also don't know what the status is.
PALS. The information sharing, you happen to, I'm so delighted somebody raised it, because this is, if there's another attack, inevitably, while information sharing between federal and state authorities is improved, you know it takes work every single day. It takes more than money. It takes money, but it takes more than money. There's a question of will, and it's still very, very difficult, even within, from across the federal government and from the federal to state and local authorities. I think that there's been a real commitment to improving it, and I expect that that will continue in the current administration. The difficulty becomes with international organizations, because, of course, if you look at Ron Noble's organization, Interpol, you have members there who are states who are state sponsors of terrorism, and so you don't want to share with them everything you share with your closest allies, and that's been a real bar. I mean, when you talk to people like the FBI about how much information they're willing to put in a system that Interpol members have access to, that continues to be, to make it a very complicated issue.
They're not going to put any good stuff in that, ever. That's a more blunt answer.
You know, did you have a question? Great.
Willa.
Yes, absolute power. So getting China and Russia on board is surely difficult, if not more so than navigating through any number of government agencies and reaching consensus. Assuming you can do that, what are the actual carrots and sticks that would neutralize action, harmful action towards the United States from North Korea and Iran?
You want to know what kinds of combinations of carrots and sticks can be offered or have been offered? Or
what it would be?
We can sort of quickly go through a list of what's been tried, and we can talk a little bit about what's out there. I think there's a little bit of consensus in some ways about what the carrots and sticks are in general. And the question, I think, both for the Bush administration and for sure for the Obama administration and even for the Clinton administration, was combination of those things and timing. Some of those things are financial. And a lot of them are financial. I mean, for the Iranians, incentives can be very basic. They can be allowing Iran to join the World Trade Organization. They can be allowing Iran, removing sanctions that prevent the Iranians from buying important airplane parts to repair their airplane industry. There's a lot of things like that. Have been bandied about, and I certainly in the last couple years of the Bush administration, they went so far as talking about even helping the Iranians with its own nuclear energy program, as long as they could find a way to keep that locked into just a program that was designed to provide nuclear power and that could not be used for nuclear weapons. And I think the sticks are pretty obvious in some ways, although I think on again for Iran on the issue of sticks, they've been diminished a little bit by the Iraq war because the Iranians feel very emboldened. And so I think the Bush administration looked very hard to find different ways to come up with sticks, including creating a coalition of allies who would work sort of together, getting the Europeans and the Russians and the Chinese to sort of work as one group that was threatening the Iranians with, you know, more sanctions at the UN, sort of, you know, being kind of frozen out of the international community. I don't know if that
that sounds right to either of you.
I think that the main carrot for these folks is the security of their regime, from direct action against the United States or some of their regional enemies that they have, and they all have them. And the main stick is money. It's financial. It's pressure on their economy.
I agree with that.
Go ahead.
Citizen preparedness. So I was thrilled when the report came out, Robin, and there was a chapter on the role of the citizen, engaging and informing the citizen. And I was curious what your sense was of how optimistic you are that that can be done when, as you mentioned, it really is a challenge because it's a fine line between basically fear-mongering and an informed, engaged citizenry. And so I wanted to your thoughts on that. And one sort of side piece, but I think it's part of it, in your discussions, even the term weapons of mass destruction, from the public's point of view, was there thought in explaining it that does chemical belong or does radiological belong in a sense, and to kind of unpack that, even that term that the public kind of knows, particularly if something happens, so that we have a better understanding of it.
Let me think about the second part. On the first part, I think all of us were absolutely astonished by Tom Brokaw's testimony before the commission. Who testified about his experience, and he had received one of the anthrax letters. Here's somebody who is extraordinarily smart, has access to virtually anybody he wants to have access to, has unlimited financial resources, and he described in the most harrowing of terms what it was like in the weeks after receiving the letter. Two of his assistants apparently were exposed, and one of them was convinced that she had anthrax. When she broke out in this hideous black lesion all across her chest, she was even more convinced. They had he went to three different doctors. He finally sent a biopsy to Fort Detrick to be evaluated, and in every single case, what came back was she had she was a victim of a brown recluse spider bite. So 3 weeks into it, when she is really sick at this point, finally a doctor comes up and says, "Yes, indeed, you were exposed to anthrax." The good news was, because of the initial diagnosis, she had been taking Cipro, which, if you take right away, in fact, can mitigate the symptoms and the consequences. What struck us in Brokaw's testimony was he sits down the day before he's going to testify, and he goes to the Department of Homeland Security and punches in anthrax attack to see what the recommendation is for what the Department of Homeland Security is suggesting we do in the event of an attack. And he said, you know, the time to consider these questions is not in the middle of an event when people are absolutely panic-stricken, but beforehand. And he said there was nothing. There was absolutely nothing on the website 7 years later. So his suggestion to us was that DHS have sort of, you know, what do the symptoms look like? Where do you go? What are the issues that you should raise with your doctor if you're exposed? What are the most likely kinds of events that we anticipate? And if you, I asked him the question, you know, well, how do you balance fear mongering with education? And his answer was the Americans are, you know, the public is pretty smart and presented with dispassionate factual information of this is what an anthrax attack looks like, this is what the symptoms are going to be like, these are the kind of questions you should ask. It's a lot better than telling us to buy duct tape and put, you know, and a couple of gallons of water and live in the basement. And I struggle with this, but I really do think that there's a way of informing the public that doesn't scare them and allows for better preparation for what may happen next.
Say something to that specifically.
Len was one of the witnesses. Well, actually, gave us an extraordinarily good kind of overview of the anthrax attack. Has written extensively on it and was very, very helpful to us.
Well, thanks, Robin. And I just wanted to say that, accurately so, DHS did not have any information on the website, and. Tom Brokaw just happened to go to the wrong site. He should have gone to the CDC,
right,
which has extensive information and should have been shared with other major agencies that people are likely to go to in case of such
an incident. But don't you think that it shouldn't be incumbent upon the American citizen to sort of ferret out where to find the right information?
Well, the downside is that some of the various agencies, Department of Agriculture, have different messages.
Right.
They do share, at least there's a sufficient overlap, so that if you listen to any of their information, you will benefit. But there should be a single message that is carried by all of the likely agencies that somebody would try to reach out to in case of an emergency. But thanks.
And by the way, on a radiological attack, they don't know yet how to respond. They don't know whether, so that's a longer answer than that. I asked for 3 years while I was NYPD and never got a straight answer out of them. And actually, that's a longer story. There was a lot of confusion about what do you do in reacting to a radiological attack.
Okay. Go ahead. We'll just bring you the microphone.
My name is Peter Weiss. I'm president of the Lawyers Committee on Nuclear Policy. Article 6 of the Non-Proliferation Treaty was supposed to be the great trade-off. 5 powers had nuclear weapons, and the rest of the world was supposed to agree never to acquire them in return for a good faith undertaking by the 5 nuclear weapons powers to negotiate for the elimination of nuclear weapons. In 1996, the International Court of Justice held unanimously that there is a general obligation, presumably binding on all countries, to pursue in good faith negotiations for total nuclear disarmament. Did any of those things play any role in your considerations? And was that kind of thing ever discussed in the White House, the legal obligation?
A lot of
people outside of Washington believe that as long as that obligation is not taken seriously, you can forget about nuclear non-proliferation.
The commission agreed with you. We didn't factor in the Court of Justice opinion, but the commission, in fact, did endorse the notion that we embraced the notion that the Reagan administration's assertion of that we ought to have a nuclear-free world. Without getting into the legal details, yes, the commission felt strongly that the NPT and its intent ought to be upheld.
But it wasn't in the
recommendations.
It's in the recommendations.
It is in the recommendations. It is.
Yeah, and I think there's also, you also discussed the role of UN inspectors, I think,
yes.
Also UN nuclear inspectors,
yep.
And funding. We'll take, I think, one more. Go ahead.
Thanks a lot. My name's Robert Jureski. I'm just a person.
you seem very nice.
Somebody mentioned that you go into a voting booth and you pull a lever and you vote for the person who's gonna defend you, but
protect.
Protect you. That's right. But what they're supposed to do is defend the Constitution from enemies, foreign and domestic. And I'm surprised at how little has been said about the law, not just the NPT, but it seems that the power of our moral example, which the new president has really run his election on as something we need to restore, is something that is sort of dismissed by the panelists, I'm sorry to say. And I'll give you just 2 examples and then ask for your response. You mentioned that exemption is still on the table. And you're talking about...
Preemption.
I'm sorry, preemption. Mm-hmm. Sorry. And preemption, my understanding of it is that it's an illegal doctrine, a doctrine where we use aggression before, not in self-defense, as the UN Charter allows us to, but when we fear the aggression of another country. That's one instance. And the other instance for accountability, which doesn't only make bureaucracies work, but it also reassures the population that we're living in a country which has a moral example. People are equal under the law. I'm sorry that your colleague, Senator Graham, isn't here tonight, because I wanted to ask him. He was the senator, the chair of the Intelligence Committee. At the time that he was briefed, one of a few Democratic leaders briefed on the use of torture by the President Bush. And he did not do anything about that. He was briefed on waterboarding. So I'm wondering about, you know, the moral example of our leaders, and whether you advocate that we have a bipartisan prosecution to reinforce the rule of law under the Constitution, under the Convention Against Torture,
you
get my point. Should we be prosecuting bipartisanly the people who were responsible for undermining WMD, the rule of law in our country?
Which is difficult to address. You know, it's up to you if you want to address it. I just feel like the panel didn't, the commission that Robin was on and that Senator Graham was on was set up by Congress to look at weapons of mass destruction. So,
to your point, I think we could say the moral leadership is a critical component in terms of addressing the issue. And waterboarding and those kind of issues, I may have personal views, but it's not worth sharing here. So,
why not?
Because it's not within the mandate of the commission's work, and I don't think that my personal views are all that important. So,
we could actually maybe have the conversation afterwards because it's kind of not part of the subject.
On preemption,
I think we answered preemption.
I think the preemption question I think any president, and whether it's preemption, whether it's the use of force, whether it's the use of diplomacy, I think President Obama and Secretary Clinton and Secretary Gates have all said the same thing, which is there are three components to American interests. We have diplomacy, we have development, and we have defense. And we need to strike the right balance in terms of the use of those elements in our interests, and no one leg of the stool should be longer or shorter than the other in terms of application. And so I would leave it at that.
Thanks, Robin.
I want to say something about the moral authority issue. Everyone wants to have good moral authority, enlightened policy, and that will help in the war against terrorism. I never use that term. Help in that endeavor. But when I was at the United Nations, and whenever I talked about terrorism, people used to respond to me, until you fix the situation between Israel and the Palestinians, you're always going to have terrorism. And my rejoinder to them on that was, well, by the way, if you did solve that issue, which included the state of Israel in existence and some compromise in Jerusalem, there are those of organizations that I was worried about that would inflame them and sense them to a higher degree. And they would come after you with even more determination. So although we all want moral high ground, that always doesn't dissuade those that are determined to kill you.
Karen, thank you. And thanks to all of you and to our panelists, of course, for participating tonight.